Oh boy. Oh boy. That's a tough one.
Who would I say that Jesus is?
I think it's likely he existed as a person. The only human who ever lived a perfect life.
Was he a carpenter? He was a carpenter.
Yeah.
He's a good guy.
Yeah, and he's also like a picture of ideality, like a picture of work, a picture of extending care, a picture of love. And as far as that's concerned, I would want to mirror him.
I think he was clearly an illuminated man. I think he changed the course, in a way, of humanity.
Almost like a link between all religions.
I think what's remarkable about Jesus being one with God is that he would associate with us.
The magic of it isn't important to me, but the fact that he was kind of a real guy who existed and had a following and like died for those beliefs and that those causes of like treat others as you would want to be treated, that sort of thing. That's the important thing to me, so.
I mean, he was definitely tapped into something. I think he was tapped into the core of what a lot of religions and spirituality kind of revolves around.
If he didn't die for our sins, I mean, we'll be dying for our sins.
So all these fabulous concepts were presented by this person called Jesus. Whether it's real or whether it's just a figment of someone's imagination, that's irrelevant.
Wow. Who is Jesus? Who is Jesus? Well, good morning. Can you guys say good morning? I can be fancy too and say buenos dias, right? Bonjour, salam, guten morning, I think is German, right? So see, we can do that too. But let's talk about this video for just a minute. Who is Jesus? Well, according to that video, it kind of depends on who you ask, right? Depending on who you ask, you might get all sorts of different answers. You might get, he was a teacher, he was a carpenter, he was a prophet, good guy. The last guy on there said, well, whether he was true or not is irrelevant. Wow. Many people are confused, honestly, when it comes to answering this question, who is Jesus? But I am very thankful that Jesus is not confused about who he is, okay? So we're going to talk about that in this series. Jesus knows exactly who he is, and he's not shy in telling us. And so I am excited to start this new series today. We're going to open God's word in just a minute. But can we just pray first? Can we just pray? And what are you going to say? No. Like, you're in church, guys. Like, come on. Okay, so let's just pray before we get into the message. Bow your heads with me. Jesus, here we are today. We are going to open your word. We're going to see what you have to say. And if you don't show up, none of this matters. And so, Jesus, I pray that today you would open our hearts, open our ears, reveal yourself to us, show us who you are today. And we just say that here we are listening. We commit to open our hearts and our ears and be listening this morning to receive what you have for us. In Jesus' name, can you guys say amen? Amen. Or in Spanish, amen. Okay, there we go. Okay, so before we get into our specific topic for today, I just want to give a little overview of this series. So this series, as Pastor Rod said, is called I Am. And I want you to think about meeting someone for the very first time, okay? When you meet someone or you introduce yourself to someone new, for how many of y'all, like, your blood pressure just went up because you hate, like, meeting new people? Anybody? Okay, I know some of y'all are like, no. But just think, when you introduce yourself to someone for the first time, you usually say something like, hello, I am Renee, right? Or I am Joe or John or Sarah, whoever. But when we just, you know, introduce ourselves right away, you know, and you know my name, you still don't know too much about me, right? If I just say, hi, I'm Renee, you don't really know too much about me. But I start revealing a little bit more about myself, and then you get to know me, right? So I might say, if I'm meeting you, I might say, I'm Renee, I'm a wife, right? I'm a mother, I'm a pastor, I'm famous for doing driveway commercials. Did any of you guys see my Donnie's driveway commercial for our back lot? Okay, I might say that. I might say something like, I like to have fun, right? I might say that I like to be in charge. Okay? Some of y'all are like, you can laugh at that, okay? It's okay. I already know that about myself, okay? I might say I'm louder than the average human being, okay? I might say I'm competitive. I might say I'm from the Midwest. I might say I eat my pizza with a fork, okay? And some of y'all are like, I'm not listening to her anymore. Anybody that eats their pizza with a fork, no. But the point is, like, I tell you some things about myself, and then you get to know me, right? The more I tell you about who I am, the more you know me. Well, Jesus does the same thing. And of course, it's infinitely more important for you to know who Jesus is than to know who I am, obviously. He wants us to know who he is. And so he reveals himself to us through scripture. Now, in the pages of the Old Testament, God the Father was constantly revealing himself to us. In fact, we did a whole sermon series here at Sea Life a few years ago on the names of God. How many of y'all were around and remember that series? Anyone? It's like vintage, so you're like showing your age, okay? Because this was a few years ago. But this series, it's still on the app. It's still on the app now, but we talked about just different ways God had revealed himself, like through his names. Like, he's Jehovah Jireh, the God who provides. Jehovah Rapha, the God who heals. Jehovah Shalom, God our peace. But see, the ultimate way that God revealed himself, his ultimate plan to show us who he is, was by taking on flesh, coming to this earth, fully God and fully man, in the person of Jesus, okay? So Jesus is how God revealed himself to us. And Jesus continues to reveal himself if we will have ears to hear. Now, that's what this series is about. In the book of John, the Gospel of John, there are seven statements, seven different times Jesus is going to say, I am, and then he's going to give us a specific metaphor, a specific definition or statement. Now, when someone tells you who they are seven different ways, I think he wants us to know him, right? He's not trying to be mysterious to us. He wants to clearly reveal himself. And so we're going to look at these seven statements in this series, because it doesn't really matter at the end of the day, right, if you know who I am, or if you know who Pastor Rod is, or if you know who XYZ person is. That doesn't really matter. But it is infinitely and eternally important. It infinitely and eternally matters that you know who Jesus is, okay? I will speak that till my dying breath. So he is revealing himself to us through these statements. So can you put those statements up? I want us just to read these together. This is where we're going for the next 7 weeks, okay? We're going to be looking at these. Can you guys read these with me on the count of three? I want to make sure. Are you guys awake? Yeah. Okay, you're too quiet in here. Let's wake up. Okay, we're going to read these together on the count of three. One, two, three. I am the bread of life. I am the light of the world. I am the door for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I am the resurrection and the life. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the true vine. So those are the things in the book of John that we're going to go through that Jesus reveals himself, okay? So today we're going to look at the first metaphor. Now in John 6:36, Jesus says what we just read. He says, I am the bread of life. Okay, this is probably like the best one, right? Don't we love us some bread? Who loves bread? Okay, so how can we love something that's just basically flour and water? I don't know, but it is so good. Like, think of some of the best bread that you have ever eaten. Okay, my kids, like, they rate different restaurants based on the free bread you get at the beginning, right? I mean, when they were little, we didn't even let them order a meal. We just made them eat the free bread, okay? So, I mean, follow me for budget-saving tips, okay? But think about some of the bread, okay? So these are for our family. Think about, like, Texas Roadhouse. Oh, yeah. I mean, those buttery rolls they give you. Do you see why Jesus said, I am the bread of life? Guys, come on, okay? Those are heavenly, right? Or maybe for some of you, it's more about like the breadsticks at Olive Garden. Anyone? Breadsticks at Olive Garden. The perfect amount of garlic, of butter, of salt, right? That doesn't do it for you. Maybe It's Red Lobster. Cheddar Bay biscuits, baby. Anybody? Right? I mean, I think they've been giving away too many of these because I heard they're going bankrupt, right? Like, hopefully they'll still be giving these away. Cheddar Bay biscuits, Red Lobster. Or maybe you're one of those, you want to go a little more locally owned. What about the Garlic Knots from Sal's? Okay, Garlic Knots. Okay, in fact, we're just going to see how unified we are here today as a church family. We're going to vote, okay? Out of those four, Texas Roadhouse, Olive Garden, Red Lobster, Cheddar Bay Biscuits, or Sal's Garlic Knots, how many of y'all would say Texas Roadhouse rolls? Oh my goodness. Okay, that's going to be hard to beat. Who would say Olive Garden breadsticks? Oh, a few of us. How many of you are Red Lobster, Cheddar Bay Biscuit? Oh, there we go. What about Sal's Garlic Knots? Oh my, guys, we are a house divided. We are a house divided. I don't know how this is going to go this morning. I don't know about this. Jesus said he's the bread of life. Now do you get why he said that? He said he is the bread of life. Please don't tune out and start thinking about where you're going to go for lunch, okay? Like for real. So today I want to look at what is Jesus trying to tell us when he says, I am the bread of life, and why does it matter, okay? We're going to be in John chapter 6. This is where he says this. John chapter 6, he says this later in the chapter, but we're going to start just where the beginning of the chapter is. It starts with one of Jesus' more well-known miracles, okay? There's like a big crowd of people following Jesus. This crowd has heard like, hey, this guy heals people. And they're intrigued by his teaching. And so a huge crowd is following Jesus, like about 5,000 people at least. And in John chapter 6, verse 5, it says, when Jesus looked up and saw a great crowd coming toward him, he said to Philip, who was one of his disciples, where shall we buy bread for these people to eat? Okay, do you think Jesus was really, like, confused about where they were going to get bread? Probably not, okay? He's Jesus. But he says this to Philip, where are we going to get bread for all these people? Philip answered him, it would take more than half a year's wages to buy enough bread for each one to have just a bite. So Philip is basically like, Jesus, it is impossible. We cannot feed all these people. We cannot cater like Panera Bread bagels for all these people. Like even if they just had one bite, like we cannot afford that. Okay, you might know the story. It goes on. Another disciple found a kid who had 5 loaves of bread, 2 fish. Jesus takes those, tells his disciples to have everyone sit down, prays over them, passes them out. Somehow, miraculously, there's enough food to go around, and there's even more food left over at the end than what they started with. That's how God's math works, by the way, okay? I'm just saying. There was more when they ended than what they started with. There's a huge miracle, and so that happens, okay, in John chapter 6. So then, at the end of the day, Jesus and his disciples, they end up crossing the lake over to the other side of the lake. And this is where we're going to pick up our text today, in verse 25. It says, when they, the crowd, had found him, Jesus, on the other side of the lake, they asked him, Rabbi, when did you get here? When did you get here? And Jesus answered them. He said, very truly, I tell you, you are looking for me, not because you saw the signs I performed, but because you ate the loaves and had your fill. Look at what Jesus is saying here. He's saying, you're just looking for me because you want another free lunch, right? He's saying, you're not looking for me. You're looking for what you can get from me. You see that? Oh, I mean, I don't know if that steps on your toes, but that convicts me, right? How many times do we do this? We're not really looking for the giver. We just want the gift, right? He says, you're not really looking for me. You're just looking for what you can get from me. Yesterday, you got the loaves and you ate. And so Jesus right here, he basically tells them, he says, you know what? There is food that spoils. Like the bread I gave you yesterday, like that would eventually spoil. But then he says, there's also food that leads to eternal life. And he tells them, I can give you the food that leads to eternal life. Now, if I'm in the crowd and I've just seen this miracle the day before, and I'm like, well, I'm hungry again because now it's been 24 hours, I'm kind of thinking like I'd probably say, well, hey, could you give me the food that is eternal, right? But not this crowd. You know what they say? They essentially say to Jesus, I love this. They essentially say, okay, prove it. Right? How many times do we say this? Like, okay, prove it, right? You say you can do this? See, in verse 30, this is what they say. So they asked him, well, what sign will you give that we can see it and believe you? Like, what? Okay, prove it. What are you going to do? And it might just be me, but I think this whole crowd is like suffering from amnesia, right? Because just 24 hours before, he just fed this crowd of 5,000 people with 5 loaves of bread. And now they're like, well, what are you going to do to prove it, right? I mean, just pause right there. Let me just say this. Some people, their hearts are so hard that it doesn't matter what miracles they see, right? They've hardened their hearts to refuse to believe. And this crowd was like, okay, prove it, prove it. And they didn't even consider what Jesus had just done. And so they basically are like, okay, Jesus, we're going to give you some ideas of how you can prove this. Because, you know, Jesus needed some ideas. So in verse 31, you know what they say? They say, well, Jesus, you know, our ancestors, they ate manna in the wilderness. As it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat. How many of y'all know the story of the manna in the wilderness in the Old Testament, right? Everyone in the crowd would have known that story. They would have been familiar with what they were talking about. That was the history of their people. See, I want to just quickly share that story because this crowd brings this up to Jesus and said, well, you know, prove it that you can give us this eternal bread. You know, I mean, our ancestors ate manna in the wilderness. And what happened is we're told back in Exodus 16 that when God had rescued the Israelites out of slavery, out of Egypt, they were crossing the desert to get to the promised land, and they found themselves in the middle of the desert with no food, okay? They were beyond hangry, okay? Have y'all been hangry before? My family doesn't like me when I'm hangry, okay? Don't say amen, babe, I'm just saying. They found themselves in the middle of the desert with no food, and they were pretty salty about it, so they grumbled and complained. And then in Exodus 16:4, it says, the Lord said to Moses, okay, I will rain down bread from heaven for you. And that's exactly what he did. That's the story that they're talking about. In fact, as you go on in Exodus chapter 16, it says, in the morning there was a layer of dew around the camp. When the dew was gone, the thin flakes like frost were on the ground. When the Israelites saw it, they said to each other, what is it? They did not know what it was, right? This is the story that they're talking about. See, the word manna actually means, what is it? They didn't recognize it. Sometimes, okay, listen up. Sometimes the things that God provides for us, they don't look like what we expect them to. So we don't recognize them. We say, what is it? What is it? Come on, that's going to preach. Someone say amen. Okay? How many of us sometimes do not recognize the blessings and the provision of God because they look different than what we expect? Right? That's what happened. God rains down bread from heaven, and the Israelites are like, what? What is this? And so Moses, you know, being the guy he is, he says, I'm going to spell this out for you guys, okay? In verse 15, Moses says to them, it is the bread that the Lord has given you to eat. Okay? He spells it out. Like, God quite literally sent bread from heaven. Okay? End of the chapter, it says, the people of Israel called the bread manna. The Israelites ate manna 40 years until they came to a land that was settled. They ate manna until they reached the border of Canaan. This manna, this bread from heaven, is literally what sustained the Israelites for 40 years in the desert. Okay? When we're talking about Israelites, I want you to think about this. When we're talking about the Israelites in the desert, we are talking about 600,000 men plus women and children. So, like 2 million people. Okay, that's a lot of Cheddar Bay biscuits, guys. That's a lot of bread, okay? That's a lot. So this is the story that these people are referring to. They're telling Jesus, well, you know what God did? He gave bread from heaven. And what kind of signs, Jesus, are you going to give us? We want something that's better than God raining down bread for 2 million people for 40 years. I mean, what are you going to do, Jesus? So back to John 6, verse 32. Jesus says, very truly, I tell you, it's not Moses who has given you the bread from heaven. It is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is the bread that comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. Okay? Now, that's a little cryptic, right? Anybody? Okay, what exactly does that mean? The crowd's like, sir, you know, so they start being polite. Sir, give us this bread. Then Jesus declared, verse 35, then Jesus declared. He didn't just say, he declared. Okay, this is like his mic drop moment. Then Jesus declared, I am the bread of life. Can you guys just say that with me? I am the bread of life. Jesus declares, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry. Whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. I love this. Jesus says, you want a sign? Hey, guys, you want a sign? You want something that's greater than your ancestors? You want something that's better, more miraculous than heaven raining bread down for 2 million people? Not once, but every day for 40 years, except for the Sabbath. And I did really fancy math, and that's 12,520 times. You're welcome, right? So that's how many days, that's how many times God sent bread from heaven for 40 years. Jesus is like, you want a sign that's better for that? I am the sign. Guys, please get excited. Jesus is like, I am the sign. You want a sign? I'm the sign. It's me. Hi, I'm the sign. It's me, right? If you know, you know. Okay, so Jesus is the sign. I am the manna. Maybe I'm not what you expected in the Savior of the world. Maybe I'm not what you expected in the Messiah. But guess what? The Israelites didn't recognize the manna either. Moses had to spell it out for them. Let me spell it out for you guys. I'm the sign. I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry. If you eat the manna, if you eat garlic knots or breadsticks or Cheddar Bay biscuits, as good as they are, you will get hungry again, right? Right? But Jesus says, I'm the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry. And then he says, okay, you want to talk about your ancestors? Verse 49. Your ancestors ate manna in the wilderness, yet they died. They died. It couldn't sustain them. Meeting their physical needs could never sustain their deepest need, their eternal needs, their spiritual needs. But here is the bread that comes from heaven, which anyone may eat and not die. Guys, eternal life. Jesus is the bread of life that sustains us eternally. You want to know who I am? I am the one who will eternally sustain you. I'm excited about this. I don't know if y'all can tell, but and I'm also hungry, too. This was a fresh revelation that Jesus is the source of life, of satisfaction. We don't just look for the gifts. We don't just look for the gifts. We look for the giver, right? He is the giver. Just like the feeding of the 5,000, the Israelites in the desert with the manna, the people were consumed with their physical needs. And God has mercy and he meets our physical needs. But please see that he cares beyond our physical needs, right? He can meet our spiritual needs. Who else can do that? No one. No one. This past week, Rod and I were up in D.C. for a couple days for our annual Foursquare Pastors Conference. And it was a really busy few days. It was full of meetings and full of sessions. But we had one day where we had a few hours to ourselves. Now, what do pastors do if they are out of town with no kids to worry about and they have a few hours to themselves? What do? We went to the Bible Museum, guys. Come on. Like, that's how holy we are. There is a Bible Museum in D.C. It's actually super awesome. I highly recommend it. We went to the Bible Museum. We are those people. The exhibits in the Bible Museum, there's the history of the Bible. There's some of the oldest fragments of the Bible. It's totally awesome. But there's this one exhibit that talks about the Bible in our modern era. In fact, they have on display the first iPhone that the Bible app was ever installed on, okay? This was in 2008, right? Some of the youth here, y'all weren't even born yet in 2008. How many of y'all weren't born yet in 2008, right? So, okay, youth, come on, raise your hand. Some of y'all weren't even, how many of you are glad there are people here that weren't even born yet in 2008? Okay, here we go. But this phone where the Bible app was first installed, the YouVersion Bible app has been downloaded 500 million times and counting. Okay, that's a lot. In one of these rooms at the Bible Museum, you could look at real-time data from the Bible app. And it was showing the verses that had been the most shared verses in the world. Now, I'm thinking, okay, this is definitely going to be like John 3:16. I mean, even if you don't read the Bible, you know there's a John 3:16, right? I'm thinking maybe it's going to be like the Ten Commandments or the resurrection or something about Christmas, you know? But as I looked at this, I clicked on the thing, you know, I was looking at all the stuff. And do you know what the second most shared verse in the world is? Put this up there. It's John 6:35, where Jesus says, "I'm the bread of life, and whoever comes to me will never go hungry." Our world is spiritually hungry, guys. Our world is spiritually hungry. We have access to the food that will eternally satisfy. Taste and see that the Lord is good. That's what it says in Psalm 34. Jesus wants us to know him as the bread of life. Have you tasted? Have you tasted? I want to, as we get ready to close, I want to show you a video. If you've zoned out, if you're like totally caught up on where you're having lunch, like just bring it back in, okay? We're almost done. But I want to end just with this video. It's just going to say it again, that Jesus is the bread of life, just in another way. Maybe you're tired of hearing me say it. But just that all of the other things that we try to fill, we try to find satisfaction in, we never will. We never will. He is the bread of life, the one that ultimately satisfies, that sustains, that gives us eternal life. So let's take a look at this video before we close.
So they said to him, "Then what sign do you do? Give us a sign so that we can believe. Moses gave us a sign. He provided us manna. What sign will you do, Jesus? What sign will you show us to affirm that you are who you say you are?" And Jesus takes that statement and he actually corrects them. "First, let me establish, it wasn't Moses that gave you that gift. It was my Father who is in heaven. And God gave you that gift through Moses." But then he says, God is still in the business of giving gifts. And guess what the ultimate gift is? It's me. The greatest gift God can give us is himself. But we're still looking for the things that moth and rust can destroy. We're still looking for the things that 5 years from now we won't even have. And he says, unlike the bread that Moses gave, this bread is never going to spoil. It's going to give you life, and it's going to give you life forever. And they're like, all the more, give us this bread. We want this bread, please. But Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life." And the truth is that satisfaction is available only through Christ. It's only through Christ. I know you may think it's other things, it's Christ and, but it's only through Christ. And he says, this bread that I'm talking about, I am this bread. And he says, whoever comes to me shall not hunger. He says, come to me and you won't hunger. What does it mean to walk with him? Do you guys see what the ultimate gift is? The ultimate gift is Christ's presence. It's the presence of the Father that comes through Jesus. When he talks about eternal life, the ultimate gift is not the golden roads. It's not the mansion. This is eternal life, that you remain with me all the way to the end, because I am the bread of life.
Will you go ahead and stand with me? As the worship team comes, I just want to ask you just a couple questions. As we've reflected on Jesus this morning as the bread of life, where have we maybe been looking for the gifts over the giver? Right? Where have we been looking for gifts over the giver? Just like this crowd, right? They were searching for Jesus because they wanted their next meal. Where are we looking for gifts instead of the giver? Where have we missed God's provision in our lives? Because it didn't look like what we expected. Right? Go ahead and throw those questions up there. Where have we missed God's provision in our lives? Because maybe it didn't look like what we expected. The Israelites didn't recognize the manna. This crowd didn't recognize Jesus standing before them. Right? Maybe things look different than what we expected and we're missing it. Right? Or how have we missed that Jesus is the sign? You know, we're asking, we're always like, God, give me a sign, right? Show me that you love me. Show me that I'm forgiven. Show me that you're going to provide for me. And Jesus is like, I am the sign. I'm right here, guys. I am the sign. How have we missed that? Or where are we looking to be satisfied outside of Jesus? In reality, the only lasting sustenance and satisfaction is found in him. You eat earthly bread, as good as it is, you'll always get hungry again. He is the only one that can satisfy. Can we just put our hands out in front of us just as a way to say, I want to receive? And would you just bow your heads and let me pray over you this morning? Jesus, we receive you right now as the bread of life. Thank you for revealing yourself to us in this way. Lord, a way we can all understand. Lord, you are the one who sustains us. Lord, help us not miss what you're doing right in front of us. Lord, we receive you today as the one who gives us everything that we need. Lord, and forgive us for the times when we've looked in all the other places that have left us hungry, that have left us wanting. And Lord, help us receive today you as our bread of life. In Jesus' name, amen.
Lord, temptation comes my way. get up, stand up, fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. More time, Lord, I need you. Lord, I need.
Reach your voice, come on.
So glad that you joined us this morning. It's great to see you in this season. We're just so thankful for you guys. And Renee and I and, you know, the whole staff, we pray for you guys weekly. So we just want to before we close this time, we want to just remind those that are here. If you're here for the first time, you're our guest, make sure you come to our welcome area. We have a gift for you. But also, we want to remind also we have our giving table in the back and beyond. So let's take a moment and just pray as we are done with this gathering. Father, we thank you. We thank you that you are the bread of life. Father, help us to remember, Father, that you are what we need the most in this season and always. I pray, Father, for our friends, for our families. Lord, help us to truly walk what we heard and what we know, Father, that is true. We just thank you so much. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, go and get some good bread, all right?
My solid ground on the straight and narrow road you sent me on. You've gone before me, guiding me along. When it's you I follow, Lord, I can't go wrong, 'cause I have found my solid ground.